Welcome back to the lecture series of function of complex variable. In the previous lecture, I have discussed what is the conformal mapping and what is the relationship between conformal mapping and analytic function, and I have given example of conformal mapping and I have given some ideas about the general complex mapping. So in today's lecture, I am going to discuss what do you mean by the bilinear transformation or Mobius transformation. That is a very important transformation or complex mapping that we are going to discuss here. So what do you mean by the bilinear transformation? So bilinear transformation actually, so already we have defined the linear transformation. So bilinear transformation is nothing but a linear transformation. So first we'll define what is the bilinear transformation, then later on we'll discuss why do we call it as the bilinear transformation. So if ABCD denote the four complex numbers where AD minus BC is not equals to 0, if this restriction is satisfied, restriction is fulfilled, then any function W, that is a function of Z. So here W and Z both are the complex numbers. Z is the independent variable and W is the dependent variable. So W equals to AZ plus B by CZ plus D, that is called as the bilinear transformation or Mobius transformation. So why this is called as the bilinear transformation? So already we have studied the linear transformation. So what is the linear transformation? Linear transformation is a mapping, a complex mapping that is nothing but the combination of the magnification, rotation and translation. So here, if we want to find out the inverse mapping, so inverse mapping will exist whenever AD minus BC will be not equals to 0. So the inverse mapping means the pre-image of W. That means W equals to SZ, so Z can be written in the form of S inverse W. So if you multiply W with CZ plus D, so WCZ plus WD will be AZ plus D. From that, if you simplify, you can get Z equals to minus DW plus B by CW minus A. So you can verify both this mapping W equals to SZ and Z equals to S inverse W, both are linear mapping. So what is the conditions we could verify whether it is a linear mapping or not? So you know that a mapping is called as the linear mapping if S of Z1 plus Z2 equals to SZ1 plus SZ2 and S of C into Z is nothing but C into SZ, then we will say that this is a linear mapping. So by using that conditions, we can verify that this mapping will also be a linear mapping. So since the mapping as well as its inverse mapping will exist whenever we are defining the bilinear transformation by this condition, both are linear. So that's why this mapping is denoted as bilinear transformation. So from here you can easily verify that whenever z equals to minus d by c, so denominator will become 0. So this mapping will be defined for z equals to minus d by c. And this mapping is defined, that means the inverse mapping will be defined whenever W is not equals to A by C. So this bilinear transformation is defined for Z not equals to minus D by C and for W not equals to A by C. I am giving one example. So say for example W is given as 3Z plus 5 by Z plus 4. So this is in the form that is given here. So here A is 3, B is 5, C is 1 and D is 4. So here you can verify AD minus BC is nothing but 7. So that is not equals to 0. So that's why this mapping, which is denoted by W equals to 3Z plus 5 by Z plus 4, is a bilinear mapping. Now we'll discuss about the cross ratio. So what is the cross ratio actually? So cross ratio is nothing but the relationship that will be valid whenever we will discuss the bilinear transformation. So under this bilinear transformation, some mapping we are considering here that will be preserved. So that is dependent on these four complex points that we are taking in the z plane and its corresponding images. So that is actually the relationship between them. So that is actually called as the cross ratio. So what is the cross ratio? So let's say z1, z2, z3, z4, the four points we have taken in order. Then the ratio, that is z1 minus z2. So we are taking this in order, z1 minus z2 into z3 minus z4. Now we will consider it cyclically. That means z4 minus z1 into z2 minus z3. That means Z1, Z2, Z3, Z4, then we will consider it cyclically, that is Z4 minus Z1, Z2 minus Z3. So in that way you can remember this. So this ratio is denoted as cross ratio whenever we are taking 4 arbitrary points Z1, Z2, Z3, Z4 in the complex domain. So that is a very significant, role whenever we will consider the bilinear transformation and whenever we will try to identify which sort of geometrical figure is mapping under the bilinear transformation from Z plane to W plane. So the cross ratio will play a very important role in order to verify this kind of thing. So then we'll discuss the theorem. So this theorem is dependent on the cross relation and bilinear transformation. So let's say we are considering W equals to AZ plus B by CZ plus D, and the Z1, Z2, Z3, Z4 are 4 points in Z plane. Then since we know that a mapping in the complex domain will map some elements Z to W, that means identify, we can identify Z in the Z plane, we can identify W in the W plane. So Z1, Z2, Z3, Z4 under the mapping W equals to AZ plus B by CZ plus D will be mapped to 4 different points in W plane. So they are say W1, W2, W3, W4. Now if we consider the cross ratio in W plane with respect to W1, W2, W3, W4, so it will be W1 minus W2 into W3 minus W4 by, we will consider cyclically, W4 minus W1 into W2 minus W3. So this cross ratio will be preserved. So actually I have not discussed the proof here, so you can verify it very easily, because W, what will be the W1? W1 will be AZ1 plus B by CZ1 plus D. In that way, Wi will be AZi plus B by CZi plus D, where I is from 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, if you put the values of W1, W2, W3, W4 here, which will be related by this relation, then it will be converted into Z1, Z2, Z3, Z4. So, we have already substituted W in terms of Z1, Z2, Z3, Z4. Now, if you put this here and simplify it, we will get this result. So, that is a very significant role of the bilinear, or significant property of the bilinear transformation. That means whenever we are considering a bilinear transformation, it will preserve the cross ratio among four points in Z plane and corresponding to the images of those four points in W plane. Then implicit formula. The implicit formula or implicit theorem is very important while we will consider how the bilinear transformation maps one geometrical figure from Z plane to W plane. So what is this formula? So we have considered say Z1, Z2, Z3. So there are 3 points in Z plane. So corresponding to these 3 points, W1, W2, W3 are 3 points in W plane. Now, if we consider a bilinear transformation, then under this transformation, say these 3 points are given. Now, by virtue of this theorem actually, we can verify or we can identify which mapping is required to transform a particular geometrical figure from Z plane to W plane. Because whenever I have discussed the conformal mapping, I have shown there, if a conformal mapping is given to us, well, let's say conformal mapping is given to us and one geometrical figure is given in the Z plane, then what will be the image of that geometrical figure in W plane we have identified. So by virtue of that theorem, what we will do here, we know that we are giving actually, so one geometrical figure in Z plane is there, that is mapped by virtue of some bilinear transformation in W plane. Now we need to identify which bilinear transformation will be applicable there in order to convert the particular geometrical figure from Z plane to W plane. So you know that if three points, say whenever we have considered the function of real variable, one real variable or more than one real variable. So if some geometrical, if some points is given to us in say as an independent variable, and corresponding to those independent variable, their images are given to us. So three or four points are given to us. They are the independent variable, and corresponding to those independent variable, the images are given to us. But it is not possible for us to construct which function will convert or which function will map the elements, the independent variables to those dependent variables. Say for example, y equals to fx. Now x1, x2, x3 is given to us. So we know corresponding images y1, y2, y3. Now it is not possible for us to construct exactly what function will map these three points to different three dependent variables. So it is not possible. But this lies the beauty in the case of complex, a function of complex variable. So here, if I know three points and corresponding to these three points, if I know its image, then I can identify which function is actually mapping those elements from Z plane to W plane by virtue of this theorem. So as per this theorem, say just we need three points, and corresponding to three points, we need the corresponding images of those three points. So that's why, if we use this property here, or if we use this theorem here, so Z1, Z2, Z3, Z4 are there. But here only three points are given, Z1, Z2, Z3. So in order to construct the function, so Z and W will be required. So actually, apart from the values, whenever we are considering the function, we actually need to construct the locus of that thing. So in order to construct the local of that thing, we require the arbitrary variable. So arbitrary variable in the Z plane will be Z, arbitrary variable in the W plane will be W. Then actually we can identify what is the relation between Z and W. So now what we are doing actually, so just instead of W1 consider W, instead of W2, consider W1, instead of W3, consider W2, and instead of W4, consider W3. Then if we use this property here, so W minus W1, so W, W1, W2, W3. So W minus W1, the W2 minus W3, then cyclically it will be rotating. The W3 minus W minus W1 minus W2. So if you take minus common, it will be coming as this. Similarly, here also it will be this. So from this theorem, if we replace Z1 by Z, Z2 by Z1, Z3 by Z2, and Z4 by Z3, and the same thing for W, then actually we will get this property from this theorem. So by virtue of this theorem, actually we can identify if a geometrical figure is given in the W Z plane and its corresponding image is given in the W plane, then which function actually transforms the geometrical figure from Z plane to W plane, we can identify by virtue of that mapping. So in this lecture, actually so far we have discussed what is the bilinear transformation, why do we call it as the bilinear transformation, what is the cross ratio. Then by virtue of the cross ratio, if some geometrical figure is given in the Z plane and corresponding to that geometrical figure its image is given in W plane, how to identify which function actually maps the geometrical figure from Z plane to W plane. So already these things we have studied in this lecture. So in the next lecture I'll discuss some examples by using which we could actually verify the theorem so far we have done. So thank you all for listening to this lecture. So stay tuned for next lecture.